bloodthirsty ghoul, Dracula. We'll walk where the real Dracula walked. Meet men and women who have followed in his blood-sucking footsteps and open coffins closed for centuries, live. So let's join our host, George Hamilton. Let's join our host, George Hamilton.
Where is he?
I can't find Mr. Hamilton.
Hello. Hi. Hello. Hello, everybody. Don't get up. I appear to be lost. I'm supposed to be hosting a live TV special here, and I'm already late. Late? Does anybody know who I am? George Hamilton? Love at First Bite. Huh? That's one of your favorites, wasn't it? Love at First Bite?
Ah, mugat ish, madam. Namuga yarto Elizabeth Taylor.
Yes, yes. Listen, I am really very late. Can you tell me how to get to Solomon's Tower? Does that ring a bell with any of you? Solomon's Tower? It's a national monument, a historic landmark. That ring a bell? Huh? Huh? First word, sounds like?
You don't want to go there at night. Alone.
Eva, I am warning you. Say no more.
This is a joke, isn't it, huh? We know that castle isn't haunted.
Ever since I was a little girl, I have heard terrible things about the man who lives inside. Unspeakable things. It is said that
Dracula lives there.
Enough! Get out!
Nem!
Set the two forks.
Don't touch the lady.
Get out!
I'm a killer, but I don't have the time.
Get out and
there'll
come
be
back.
No tip for you.
Get out!
This is not the last you hear from me.
Get out!
Ava, wait. Look, why don't you drop by the castle for a drink? We'll have the run of the place. I've got a lot of pull with the company, and maybe I can get you a job in the catering service.
No, don't be concerned with me. It's you who should worry.
But vampires don't really exist. I should know. I played one. That's why I'm going up to the castle to find out the real story.
The castle is an evil place. I warn you.
Oh.
Is there an assistant director anywhere around?
Yeah, over here, right here.
Oh, hi, George Hamilton. I'd like to go to my dressing room, and I'm going to need some makeup.
On your mark, we are.
And then I'll run my cards in a minute.
On your mark, we are on live.
Live?
Yes.
You're on live now? Hello, everybody. I'm I'm George Hamilton. We're well, thank you very much. We're here. Yes, indeed, we're here.
Live?
We're here live. Dracula is the Prince of Darkness, a specter who haunts our nightmares, swooping down into our subconscious. Tonight, in an unprecedented live event, we're going to explore the dark recesses of history and... Wait, just, I can't even read those cards. How could you put those cards up? If you at least hold them upright. Wait, just put down the cards, will you? You want live, you're going to get live, okay? I've been told that this place is literally crawling with people who take this vampire thing real seriously. Now, frankly to me, vampires have always been guys in funny suits mispronouncing vows as they check out their deodorant. Good evening. Put a bit me to introduce myself. You know, stuff like that. I did it in the movie. You saw it. But I've been told if I just sort of approach this thing with an open mind, it may change the way I think. Permanently. Well, I'm game. How about you? Okay, go ahead now. Go ahead with your show. Cue the announcer. Go ahead. Cue the lightning. Instant Hollywood. Not so bad. Big deal. Can I go get my makeup now? Do you mind if I get checked? Okay, thank you.
Tonight, live from Transylvania, the real story of Dracula. We'll meet Vlad the Impaler, the real-life Dracula, torturer, sadist, and murderer of over 100,000 men, women, and children. But to many people, he is still a national hero. We'll walk the original English cobblestones, where Bram Stoker brought Dracula to life, and discover one of the most valuable manuscripts in all of literature, hidden for years in an ordinary Pennsylvania barn. We'll go back in time 500 years and hear the chilling tale of Elizabeth Báthory, the fiendish countess who sacrificed 650 virgins for the sole purpose of bathing in their blood. Noreen Dresser is an American folklorist with a mission to find out why Dracula has become a national obsession. Recently, this quiet English cemetery was the setting for a mysterious and deadly series of incidents. Scores of witnesses swear they saw a vampire stalking through these gravestones, and experts believe they were telling the truth. We'll meet the world's two leading authorities on Dracula, Professor Radu Florescu and Raymond McNally, and find out why the most frightening thing about the legend of Dracula is that much of it is true.
Sounds like we're in for some fun tonight. Now, if I can just find the front door, we can get started. Catch you in a moment. Yoo-hoo! Anybody home? Yoo-hoo!
They've tried to serve him up in many ways.
Bake it? Fry it?
But no remake could ever surpass the terror of the original The Thing.
We underestimate this guy.
And now we've made The Thing more electrifying than ever, in color.
You're wiser than anything on Earth.
Don't miss the discovery of the century.
You realize what we've found?
A shocking special color presentation, The Thing.
A world television premiere, Thursday night at 8, as Spirits in the Night Week continues on Channel 20.
I'm Gilbert Reynolds, auto technician at Jengris Motor Cars. Fixing automobiles used to be just a hobby of mine. Then I enrolled at the Hartford Technical Institute. Now I'm a professional, working on Mercedes-Benz and BMWs and getting top pay.
There's no room for amateurs in today's skilled job market. At Hartford Tech, you too can turn pro. At Hartford Tech, you can learn from the pros in an authorized service center. If your career is going in the wrong direction, turn it around. Turn pro at Hartford Technical Institute.
Hartford Technical Institute. Call 249-8688.
Most of the time, after a manufacturer puts the finishing touches on a suit or sport coat, he ships it to a wholesaler who marks it up. He, in turn, ships it to a retailer who also marks it up. But there is a manufacturer who ships his garments directly to his own stores, which is why his suits and sport coats carry a different mark. Anderson Little, a good suit at a good price.
If the only thing exciting about your car is a $1,000 repair job, and your warranty ran out months ago,
Shift to Pontiac excitement. The 1990 Grand Am. With full 48-month, 4.8 APR GMAC financing, you can buy a brand new Grand Am LE Coupe for just $199 a month. $199 a month. Shift to Pontiac excitement. See why Pontiac outsells all the imports. See your Connecticut Pontiac dealers now.
Welcome back. We appear to have some company here. Hello? Hello in there. Come on, this is no time to play hide and seek. Don't be scared. This is just live television. Millions of people hanging on every word, secretly waiting for you to make some career-ending mistake. Nothing to worry about. Already ended.
Welcome. I'm Radu Florescu.
How do you do, George Hamilton? Pleasure to meet you. You from around here?
No, I'm from nearby Romania. My family has served my country for some 500 years. But also, I'm a relative of Dracula.
Oh, then you must be related to Bela Lugosi?
Bela Lugosi was a Hungarian actor. I'm related to the real Dracula. He was a prince who's known as Vlad Tepes, which means Vlad the Impaler, also known by his detractors as Vlad the Devil, or Son of the Devil.
Son of the Devil, huh?
Yes, by his enemies. But my ancestors would look upon him as a son of the dragon. It was a military order of knights which fought for the cross. He was a national hero.
Uh-huh. Did he live here, the Son of the Devil? Did he live right here?
He lived in Visegrad in the 1460s, and enjoyed a tremendous, overawing reputation. People came from distances to see him. I'd like to show you the tower where he may have spent some time, the Solomon's Tower.
Well, sure, why don't you just lead on?
Come on, follow me.
I will. It's a pretty scary place. Tell me, what was Solomon's Tower like back in the bad old days?
Not so bad, really, because it was a place where the Hungarian kings entertained the flower of the nobility, kings, prelates, representatives of the popes. A splendid place.
Oh, sort of like a Dark Age Aspen, huh?
I would deny that. I think Solomon's Tower and the whole castle was, in fact, they speak of it as an earthly paradise. For the Hungarians, it was a golden age.
But you also said it was a prison.
Yes, Solomon's Tower was occasionally used as a prison, and there were tiny cells for high security prisoners.
Why don't you show me some of that?
Let's go and see it.
Okay.
It's exciting for me to walk here when I think that Dracula, in this very place, was wooing the sister of the Hungarian king. And that many artists came to paint him. He was, in fact, painted here.
They painted his body?
No, they painted him fully clothed.
Scared? Cold, though, isn't it? Thank you.
George, look yonder. Here's the blue Danube, which has divided nations in the past and reunited them in Dracula's time.
Wow, what a view, huh? Prime real estate, perfect for a few condos, liberal pet policy, bats welcome. Tell me, does Transylvania really exist?
Yes, it means the land beyond the forest. It's now part of Romania. In Dracula's time, it was part of the Hungarian kingdom. It was land of Germans, Hungarians, and Romanians are kind of Switzerland of Eastern Europe. They fought against common oppressors, including the Turks.
Well, somehow, when I think of Transylvania, I think of a place, you know, sort of dark, gloomy, scary, sort of like this.
This was just bad press. Transylvania has been badly treated in the American newspapers. I think it's a land of gorgeous mountains, crystal lakes, a land of beautiful castles, of great opportunity. Gold was to be found, a California of the Middle Ages.
Well, if you say so. It's been nice talking to you with you. I'm a little scared of heights. I'm scared of heights, so I think I'll just mosey on down, go inside. I'm expected. Maybe I'll see you later.
Well, I also have some research up the castle, but perhaps we can have you for dinner.
I'm a tad behind schedule at the moment. I'll try to drop by. And until then, how do you say until then in Dracula's language? How do you say that?
Până atunci.
Până atunci, yeah. Până atunci. Până atunci. So what do you think? You believe there really was a Dracula? Sounds a bit bogus to me. Frankly, when I'm planning my next vacation, I doubt Transylvania will be at the top of my list. How you doing? You making it okay? Not scared? Good. I can see the light at the end of the tunnel now. Wait for me.
Made it. I think we should go inside, don't you? Yoo-hoo! Anybody home? Don't worry, they're expecting me. Look, I don't want to keep you. Why don't you come back in a minute? Trick or treat! I'm in my George Hamilton costume. Come and check it out!
With real lemon juice.
My skin has changed since I've gotten older. I'm worried about dryness.
Dove contains 1/4 moisturizing cream. It won't dry your face like soap.
And with Dove, my face doesn't feel dry like with soap. It's funny to say this at my age, but it feels younger.
From Wes Craven.
Don't let him take your soul.
Come on!
Director of the original Nightmare on Elm Street.
Come on, Dad.
Comes his most terrifying creation.
No more!
100,000 volts of pure evil. Shocker.
No more Mr. Nice Guy.
Radar starts Friday at a theater near you.
Think of your hands and think of a name. For years, it's healed and restored rough, dry skin. Now there's something more. Announcing new, improved Vaseline Intensive Care. An even better formula with more healing ingredients. It heals rough, dry skin fast. So when you think of your hands, think of our name. New, improved Vaseline Intensive Care Lotion. Now with even more healing ingredients.
Hold out your finger, please.
In the last year or so, millions of people have decided to have their cholesterol checked. Many of them have also started eating healthier, including foods like Kellogg's Common Sense Oat Bran, with more oat bran than any leading ready-to-eat cereal. If you haven't tried either one of these things, we'd like to recommend them. There's at least one you'll really enjoy. Kellogg's Common Sense Oat Bran. To millions of people, it's the oat bran that makes sense.
Hello, open up. There's several million people waiting out here. At least there were a few minutes ago.
Must be keep George waiting a week. Well, while we're waiting, the story of Dracula has managed to hold the attention of the world ever since it was written in 1897. For example, did you know that a surprising percent of the people in the United States believe that vampires might really exist? Sound hard to believe?
It's true.
Now, I'm not one of those people, but still, if you look around, vampires.
The image of the vampire for most Americans is based on the Bela Lugosi film. We can attribute the popularity to the influence of the media. It started with the 1931 movie Dracula, which starred Bela Lugosi, and that's been rerun. And we have almost every year, we have two or three or four new films based on the whole notion of the vampire, with slight variations, of course.
In a recently published book, American Vampires, author Noreen Dresser discovered that people in the United States take vampires very seriously.
I ran a survey, and in that survey, 27% of my population, which was a small population, but it was high school and college students, 27% of them said they believed it was possible for vampires to exist as true entities. I found that very surprising. It's the media that constantly teaches the new generations all about vampires. It's the television that constantly replays the old movies and the old television serials like Munsters and Dark Shadows.
Vampires have become as all-American as apple pie. They're everywhere. It's hard to believe that vampires have been turned into something almost cuddly. The ultimate fate of many a popular myth.
The vampire is almost as common as the Big Mac. The vampire is seen on a bumper sticker. The vampire is seen at the breakfast table. The vampire is seen in the workbook for the first graders. The vampire is found in greeting cards. It's a very popular figure now during Halloween time. It's almost a classic Halloween figure.
Though Americans have turned vampires into consumer items, other cultures are still frightened by their hidden power and their potential for evil.
Vampire lore is taken more seriously in other cultures. We find it all over the world. We find it in Asia, we find it in Middle Europe, we find it in Africa and in South America. And in those places, it's thought of more realistically. When things go wrong, if a child is born malformed, it's thought that the vampires caused it. The vampire in other places is often a scapegoat.
No matter how we think about vampires, chances are we first saw them on the movie screen. Women in particular respond to Dracula's fatal attraction.
One woman said that for her what was the exciting part was his foreplay. And she said, American women, she said, if statistics are to be believed, complain about lack of foreplay during the sexual act, and she said the vampire is all foreplay. So maybe that's one reason. Some of the women like that feeling of being taken. Now, he takes you not with violence, it has nothing to do with rape or anything like that. He takes with elegance and with style, and it's never a violent act. And so they identify with being taken by this very elegant man with the accent.
Well, remember me, Fraser. You asked for it.
Now, are women turned on by the character of Dracula or by the man playing him? Well, when I portrayed him, the answer was, well, never mind, but maybe there's more to playing Dracula than meets the eye. Behind door number one, if we live long enough, maybe we'll learn more.
Hello?
Welcome. You are expected. Your mantle, sir.
My what?
Your mantle.
Oh, my mantle. Okay, thank you. Too much sunblock. Should I? It's a little bit scary, but nothing I can't handle. You know, when I first put on the satin cape for Love at First Bite, I was following in a distinguished tradition. First, I felt it was just another role. But when I really studied the work of my predecessors, I began to feel quite differently. There's just something about playing a vampire that has a strange kind of power. If you look closely at some of the people who played it, well, the line between art and reality becomes a little bit blurred. Shut up, Mama! Old bat. Nothing to be afraid of. To the men and women who've acted out this dark fantasy, it's always been transforming. Maybe that's the reason we keep coming back and back. Take Bela Lugosi, for instance. Great man, but died miserable, broke, penniless. Wrapped in the very costume that had brought him to world fame. Which way did he go? This way or that way?
Please. Visitor.
Oh, what are you doing here? What a surprise. I thought you were scared of this place.
I could not sleep. I kept thinking about you.
I know how that is.
No, here. This is to protect you.
What is that, garlic? Did you bring the basil and the olive oil, too?
No, you must take it.
I don't think so. It'd wreak havoc on my social life.
Please, please, please for me.
You silly, charming native girl with your superstitions. Okay, come here. I was just reading this book. You know, I was wondering, do you think it's every woman's fantasy to be hypnotized by a powerful man? To have your very essence consumed in a passionate embrace that holds the key to eternity, do you?
George, someone could be watching.
I hope somebody's watching. The eroticism of Dracula always surprises us. You know, people back in the Victorian age really must have been surprised by this book of Bram Stoker's. Listen to this. The girl went on her knees and bent over me, simply gloating.
Gloating.
Yes, gloating. There was a deliberate voluptuousness which was both thrilling and repulsive. And as she arched her neck, she actually licked her lips like an animal, till I could see in the moonlight the moisture shining on the scarlet lips and on the red tongue. It lapped the white, sharp teeth. Huh. Sounds like my ex-wife. I closed my eyes in a languorous ecstasy. It waited. Heart beating. Wow. Bram Stoker. Who is Bram Stoker? And how did he create this legend, both terrific and erotic? Stay tuned.
George, listen to this. This crazy man Renfield eats flies. Here. For when a horrid blowfly, bloated with some carry-on food,
buzzed into the room. He caught it, and before I knew what he was going to do, put it in his mouth and ate it.
When we come back, we'll visit Dracula's birthplace. We'll walk the streets he walks. Stay with us. What is it with you? First garlic, now flies? Can't you find some?
When we return, the real story of how Dracula came to be. For over 70 years, the priceless secret lay hidden in a small Pennsylvania barn. So stay tuned as Dracula, live from Transylvania, continues.
Even after lying around for 3 years, today's Duracell batteries still have up to 90% of their life. Today's Duracell, date-coded for 3 year storage.
Ever think of shrimp for lunch? Then think Red Lobster for golden fried shrimp, crunchy popcorn shrimp, and sizzling scampi, all on one plate for just $4.95. Served in 15 minutes guaranteed or it's free. The Lunch Shrimp Trio, now at Red Lobster.
Doctor, flying in a multiple trauma from Woodlake.
What are the injuries?
I need an EKG, current and basic.
It's been done at Woodlake.
I don't need them there, I need them here.
In the time it takes to transfer a patient, this doctor is able to prepare a treatment. Because now the network of U.S. Sprint can fax the sharpest graphics in the world in only 6 seconds.
Let's do it!
100% digital fiber optic fax, only from U.S. Sprint.
If oat bran is such a serious topic, why is this woman smiling? And if America knows how serious oat bran is, why don't they look serious? Simple. They've got Kellogg's Common Sense Oat Bran Waffles from Eggo. Oat bran in crispy, delicious Eggo waffles. And if millions of people are enjoying oat bran this much, the question really is, why aren't you? Common Sense Oat Bran Waffles from Eggo. Oat bran, you can actually smile about.
Sometimes you feel like a nut, sometimes you don't.
Almond Joy's got nuts, nuts, nuts.
Almond Joy's got rich milk chocolate, coconut and munchy nuts too. Mounds got deep dark chocolate and chewy coconut, ooh.
Sometimes you feel like a nut, yeah. Sometimes you don't.
Almond Joy's got nuts, nuts, nuts.
Because
sometimes you feel like a, sometimes you.
Eat your home-cooking soup, Rosie.
It's different.
Oh, that's just the new label. Don't you recognize all the delicious chicken and carrots and noodles? They just changed the home-cooking on the outside, not the home-cooking on the inside.
Home-cooking soups from Campbell's.
I used to think spaghetti sauce was spaghetti sauce. But you know, when you see Prego and Ragu side by side, the difference really comes through. Mmm.
Prego spaghetti sauce. Homemade taste. It's in there.
Welcome back to Dracula, live from Transylvania, with our host, George Hamilton.
I'm here with Bernard Davies, the chairman of the Dracula Society. Yes, I know what you're going to say. Just what kind of society is that? Well, we're talking about something that's an historical group dedicated to learning the truth about how Dracula was born. Is that correct?
Yeah.
Well, what was Bram Stoker really like? Based on his book, I doubt he was great fun at parties.
Oh, he loved parties.
Really?
Yeah. Bram Stoker was a big, outgoing, popular sort of fellow. He had to be. He was Henry Irving's front of house manager. And he had a great sense of humor, too. And incidentally, there's a lot of humor in Dracula and irony. Like, for example, the predicament of the Count at the beginning, where he's stuck in that drafty castle with three nagging wives, having to do all the cooking and washing up himself. And then there's the way that Stoker stuffed his heavy-breathing text with little in-jokes, names of persons and places, which only certain friends and relatives could understand. Well, it's plain to me that a lot of Dracula was written with a twinkle in his eye and his tongue very firmly in his cheek. Oh, I know people love psychoanalyzing poor old Bram and arguing that, of course, he couldn't possibly have known what a raunchy book he was writing. And therefore, he must have been writing it in a white-hot fever of sexual frustration. I doubt it. Stoker, you know, he was a craftsman soaked in the Gothic. He knew all about the erotic symbolism of the horror literature of his day and how to use it, too. Oh, yes. And anyway, Why should a manager of a theatre full of ambitious young actresses need to be frustrated? It beats me. Besides, after all, damn it, it took him 8 years to finish it.
8 years of sexual frenzy, huh? Wow. Oh. What do you know about the creation of Dracula? Where did Stoker get the basic idea?
Well, I think he'd always had an ambition to write the great vampire novel. Mm-hmm. He loved supernatural, and he greatly admired Sheridan Lefanu, whom he once worked for in Dublin. And Lefanu's Carmilla, marvellous vampire tale, influenced him very much. But he wanted to make his vampire special. And his basic idea was his own invention. Mysterious foreign nobleman cons English lawyers into helping him establish a base in London without revealing that he's really a vampire. And Stoker was determined that his vampire should be rooted in Eastern European folklore, mm-hmm. warts and all. Oof. Not a pretty picture. Mm-hmm. And right against the popular Victorian obsession, which goes back to Edgar Allan Poe and Byron with the beauty of the dead. Oh, his theme became so top-heavy with ideas and time that it almost overwhelmed him. And just what a problem that was revealed by the discovery of his original manuscript.
Original manuscript, that's right. That must be worth a fortune, huh?
Well, George, you know, many of us dream of finding treasure buried in our back garden, but most of us are disappointed. Yet a few years ago, a young couple found in an empty barn in Pennsylvania a most unusual treasure.
In a mystery that spanned over 80 years and a great ocean, the original manuscript of The Undead, later to be known as Dracula, was found. This barn had stood for over 100 years. Inside, locked away in 3 trunks, were the belongings of one of the farm's previous owners. One spring, the new owners decided to take a look inside. They found 3 trunks, filled with mementos of a life in the theatre. In the first trunk, there lay a pile of yellowed papers, handbills, and playbooks. The second trunk contained costumes, musty, but still intact. The third trunk contained a grisly surprise. With rats. Dozens of mummified rats. And nothing else. For the first time, literary archivists were able to explore how Dracula's creator turned his imagination into an enduring classic.
Is that
all I have in my attic are a couple of 1,000 cases of suntan oil. Now, how did that manuscript get in the trunk?
Well, it's my guess that Stoker sent it after publication to one of his friends in the American theater to see if it was possible to make it into a viable play. Well, it never was. At least, not until another quarter of a century. As for the manuscript, or rather, typescript, well, that actually is almost identical with the first edition. But it's in an incredible condition. All slashed and spliced and with odd pages pasted together, complete chapters cut and last-minute alterations in the margin, in longhand, right up to the time of going to the printers. Actually, you know, Stoker was a great part of the theatre for 30 years, and it's likely that Count Dracula was partly based on Henry Irving on the stage.
Really?
And maybe off the stage too, because he could be a charming man, Irving, but he was secretive, manipulative, and very difficult.
Yeah, I can believe it. I worked with a couple of actors that make Dracula look like Mr. Rogers. Sounds like Stoker based a lot of Dracula on fact, is that right?
No, that's the interesting part of the book, and it's and in England today, you know, some of his main haunts, one main haunt in particular, looks exactly as he described it. Because when Count Dracula comes to England, this was his first port of call.
Really? I keep forgetting. Dracula was set in England, wasn't it?
Yes. And what's more, Stoker used often real news events, such as the wreck of a real Russian schooner, to make the book more effective, rather in the way that Stephen King uses popular culture in his books. And like the modern horror classics, Dracula, at the time it was written, was considered the ultimate in horror.
Only Dracula wore a cape, not a hockey mask, right? Bernard, we're going to have to take a break now. I'd like to hear more, but do you mind hanging on?
Certainly.
Well, how about you? Just hang on with us a little while, and we'll be right back with Dracula, live from Transylvania.
By the way, who's Mr. Rogers?
You don't know who Mr. Rogers is?
It's almost time. Time for Halloween Fright. A Halloween night when no one comes home. Watch, if you can, Halloween 3, Season of the Witch.
Happy Halloween.
Saturday night at 8 on WTXX TV, Channel 20.
wait a second. I want you to put this on.
What?
Come on, spoil all the fun. Look, you don't have to worry about getting pregnant. Come on.
Well, I'm worried about AIDS.
AIDS?
Yeah.
AIDS? Come on, how long have you known me?
Well, for 3 years, off and on.
Oh, come on, really. What? No, what makes you think a nice guy like me could have AIDS?
Well, what makes you think a nice girl like me couldn't?
Everyone's rushing in because someone didn't raise prices. Your Toyota dealer, home of the 1990 Toyota Camry, at a price you'll swear was last year's. Plus, factory option packages could save you up to $735. Dealer discounts could save you even more, but you'd better hurry. At 1989 prices, 1990 Camrys are moving out fast. At your Toyota dealer, don't you dare miss it.
Hold everything, Mom. Sugar's one part of your kid's diet you don't need to supplement. That's why they're sugar-free Bugs Bunny. All four Bugs Bunny chewable vitamins help complete their balanced diets. With no sugar, artificial flavors, or preservatives added.
Mom and kids love Bugs Bunny because it's sugar-free.
Welcome back to Dracula, live from Transylvania, with our host, George Hamilton.
So, how about Captain Kangaroo? You heard about him, haven't you?
No.
Well, before I met you, I really never knew much about Bram Stoker either. You said earlier that Dracula took about 8 years to write. Now, was it all written in England?
Yes, and that's the interesting point. He often used real events, and like the wreck of a real Russian schooner, for example. And
let me ask you another question. Are there any notes or anything that was ever put together that gave us any sort of history? How do we know about it?
I mean, oh, yes, the notes kept in Philadelphia.
Philadelphia?
They tell us quite a few things, yes.
Well, was there a manuscript? Where was it found?
Oh, the notes were found in a collection, and they're in Philadelphia. They tell us quite a bit about his methods of research and sources of his material.
Really?
Chiefly, though, I think they illustrate his changes in his planning of the thing over the 8 years, of course, because the final version was very different from the original one. They illustrate his changes of thought and revisions over things like locations and even some of the characters. Like the complete revision, for example, that he did when he decided suddenly that he needed a shipwreck. And so he thought that the Yorkshire port of Whitby, a very picturesque spot full of the legendary of the sea, that might be just the place.
By all accounts, Bram Stoker was a modest, quiet man. He was also a very busy one and could only write in his spare time. In 1890, he fixed his annual vacation in Whitby so as to give himself a week there alone before he was joined by his wife and small son to soak up the atmosphere and the sights and sounds of the place. The town of Whitby has remained relatively unchanged since Stoker's time. The ancient abbey still stands, gaunt from ruin. Beside it, a graveyard can be found, overlooking the desolation of the North Sea. Stoker copied down some of the names on these graves and gave these dead immortality by using their names in his manuscript. In Stoker's time, boats used to regularly dock, bringing cargo from all over Europe. Today, the harbour is usually empty. In Dracula, the arrival of a ghostly ship is what heralded the great terror. Dracula's terror. The small church of St. Mary played a prominent role in Dracula. And at sunset, the sun reflects off the windows, the inspiration for the terrible red eyes of Count.
I understand Bram Stoker is some sort of a hero in Whitby.
Ah, that depends on whom you talk to. Of course, the local stores and the hotel keepers, they think he's great. Dracula brings in the tourists. But the rector of St. Mary's does get a bit annoyed, you know, people trampling over his graveyard and asking damn fool questions like, whereabouts is Dracula buried? He wasn't. this might interest you, you know. It's one of the earliest typewriters ever used, identical to the one that typed the manuscript of Dracula.
Pretty high-tech, huh?
Yes, it was for its day. But then Dracula is full of modern technology. Victorian technology.
Really? Well, I wonder what his fax machine was like.
You see, as a practical man of the theatre, Stoker was absolutely fascinated by technological innovations, and he used them in stark contrast to the medieval horror of the vampire. Harker uses the first Kodak camera to take snapshots, while Mina has a portable typewriter, very new, takes it with her everywhere. That's something that Stoker himself might have done. And Dr. Seward, he puts his case notes and diaries down on an Edison phonograph. And when the friends go to search Dracula's house, well, they have not just crucifixes, oh no, but the latest modern invention, electric torches.
Ah. Yeah,
clipped to the jacket lapel and wired to little dry cells in the pocket. You know, Bram Stoker got that idea off of Irving, who used something very similar in his Mephistopheles costume for Faust.
Really? That sort of sounds like Jules Verne, I think.
Exactly. That book is as obsessed with gadgets as the James Bond novels of Ian Fleming.
So the title of the book wasn't always called Dracula?
No, actually, no. The original title was The Undead. Stoker actually invented that word, and he didn't change it until the very eve of publication.
He evidently took some very sound advice, for he had found a name and a title to conjure with. Stoker had originally named his demonic creation Vampire. Bram Stoker worked for years researching his manuscript. By the time he sat down to type his immortal work, the writing went quickly. Stoker's original title was sure to strike terror into the heart of the reader. He called his creation The Undead. And that title stood all the way through to the eve of publication. During his research, another name came to his attention. One day, he happened across an obscure history book on Transylvania. In it, he saw a name that fired his imagination. It belonged to a Romanian prince who lived in the 15th century. This man's bloody deeds stood out in an era known for its brutality. The prince's subjects called him Vlad the Impaler. But to Western visions, he was known by his surname, Dracula.
Then Dracula was for real, huh?
In a manner of speaking, yes. And the 15th century Germans were so keen to read about him that pamphlets were the most bloodthirsty illustrations, the sort of video nasties of their day.
Right.
Sold like hotcakes. Remember, Dracula has been a bestseller twice. A novel sold quite well, though Stoker didn't make a fortune from it.
Mm.
But others did. You know, the sales grew and grew long after he was dead. And of course, the Countess films helped, so it was never really out of print. Perhaps the most prophetic words any author ever wrote were the words he put into the mouth of Count Dracula at bay. Time is on my side. How true that turned out to be.
I bet the Count's a little annoyed he didn't get a piece of the action, huh? He pays to have a smart lawyer. Well, Bernard, they tell me I need to head back into the confines of this lovely establishment. I'll eventually drop by and see you later, okay?
Okay, yeah. Oh, George, take this with you. Trust me, it's dark down there.
Down there?
That way.
That way. Easy gig, my agent said. Be over before you know it, he said. I wonder what he's lined up for me next. Live from Chernobyl. Is the reactor really cooled off? George Hamilton finds out live!
When we return, the gruesome tale of Prince Vlad, the real-life Dracula. He murdered over 100,000 people, and his method of mutilation earned him the grisly nickname, the Impaler. So stay tuned to Dracula, live from Transylvania.
Help me! He came back to finish the job that gave him so much pleasure last time. How do you kill someone who isn't alive? Donald Pleasance can't believe his eyes, while Jamie Lee Curtis lives in terror for his amusement. Halloween 2, Monday night at 8 on WTXX-TV, Channel 20. By all means, watch it with a friend.
High-tech careers start at Hartech. Be a part of advanced technology, the world of computerized numerical control machining. Hartech can help you move up your earnings and career in just 6 months. Hartech is Pratt & Whitney Machine's authorized training center. If you're good with your hands, good with tools, and interested in computers, Hartech can put you in a better job. If your career is going in the wrong direction, turn it around. Turn pro at Hartech. Call Hartford Tech at 249-8688.
Your Nissan dealer is having a fall clearance, so if you need a car with more power, more room, or more of everything, see your Nissan dealer now, because he's making the best deals of the year on all his Nissans, like the rugged yet comfortable Pathfinder. Not only does it come with a powerful fuel-injected V6 engine and a 5-link coil spring rear suspension, but it also comes with dealer cash incentives. So get down to your Nissan dealer's fall clearance now, because the only thing we can't give you is more time.
Happy Halloween! I'm Dumpy the Pumpkin, the fresh ice cream cake made daily at Carvel.
Are you having a Halloween party? Go to your participating Carvel ice cream store and ask to see us, Dumpy the Pumpkin, and me, Wiki the Witch.
Go to your participating Carvel ice cream store and pick up our latest coupon book. Inside, there's savings on ice cream cakes for Halloween, Thinny Thin dietary frozen dessert, and Loyo frozen yogurt.
Eva? This is no time to play hide and seek. Children of the night, shut up! They tell me that Dracula lived in this castle in the 1460s. Of course, he wasn't a willing guest. They held him prisoner here in one of these empty chambers. I said, empty chambers. Could that be him?
I didn't mean to scare you.
Who are you?
And who are you?
I ask you first.
Well, my name is Radu. I am a humble historian trying to learn about my illustrious ancestors. Come. And now, who are you?
Just a humble actor in search of a character. We were just talking about your illustrious ancestor, Vlad the Impaler. I believe he was a guest in this lovely establishment.
Mm-hmm. Prince Vlad, that is who brings me here.
Me too.
I have reason to believe that this was his chamber. Look, I found many small animal bones in this coffin. And also,
what's that, a medieval toothpick?
The mark of the Impaler. This stake is the key to his personality. Note, the end is blunt. That was so his impaled victims wouldn't die immediately. Vlad wanted to see them suffer. That was the point.
Really? Some point. What about those animal bones?
Oh. When he was imprisoned, his guards brought him small animals. He used to skin them alive and then impale them.
What else do you know about this fun guy?
Well, that he was born in 4031, and that his father's name was Dracul, and his son was named Dracula in his honor. To people who met him, Dracula was a handsome man. He was of short stature, with fair hair, a pale complexion, and a large flamboyant mustache. But behind the enigmatic expression in this painting, there lay a cunning and cruel mind. Woodcuts made immediately after his death illustrated atrocities that had all of civilized Europe frightened. Dracula would impale without hesitation anyone who displeased him. During his reign, it is believed that he had 100,000 people killed under the most horrible tortures imaginable. Death claimed the Impaler under mysterious circumstances in 1472. The bloody reign of Vlad Tepes, Dracula, finally came to an end.
Tell me something. Do you know where he's buried? I'd like to dance on his grave. No?
No.
Oh.
No. You couldn't do that for two reasons. First, no one knows where he's buried. And secondly, many people around here still regard him as a hero. Something like your George Washington.
No, no, no. George Washington may have cut down a cherry tree with an axe, but that's where he drew the line. You can't be serious.
I am completely serious.
They called her the Mad Countess, and she killed hundreds for the secret of eternal youth. Her elixir, the blood of innocent girls? Did her terrible secret die with her? Find out when Dracula, live from Transylvania, continues.
What you want, I can read your mind.
Tyson Gourmet Dinners.
'Cause you and me, we're two of a kind.
The kind of dinners you just might not cook yourself.
We'll just family, yum, you yum, and yum, Tyson. Feeding you is good, yum, as good as good can be.
Even if you're eating alone, at Tyson we cook every dinner as if you were eating with our family.
Tyson's feeding you like family. Tyson's feeding you.
Announcing our newest arrival, new Nine Lives Kitten Dinners. They're just right for delicate digestive systems. Perfect for tiny teeth. With just the right vitamins and minerals these babies need to get off to a healthy start. New Nine Lives Kitten Dinners. 100% perfect nutrition right from the start.
I think children should be seen and not heard.
Why is grapefruit juice like the Florida sun? Well, grapefruit juice isn't a red-hot fireball in the sky, but it will brighten up your day and put a sparkle in your eye. And while it's true that Florida grapefruit juice won't give you a tan on the outside, its cool, refreshing taste will make you glow on the inside. So for the perfect refreshment anytime, let the sun go down and be sure to stock up on the delicious taste of 100% pure Florida grapefruit juice.
I got just two things to say about this cereal. Boring. It's too simple. These days you gotta add oats or straw or hay or something. This is nothing but flakes.
Hmm. All right, the taste is good. I'm kind of shocked that something as simple tastes as good. You know, I think your simplicity angle will work after all. This cereal might just make it.
Kellogg's Corn Flakes.
Corn Flakes? Hey, can I pick a winner or what?
Taste them again for the first time.
Only Sunkissed children's multivitamins have the delicious Sunkissed fruit taste kids love. Plus, the essential vitamins kids need.
Great vitamins!
Great! Great vitamins plus great fruit taste only from Sunkissed.
Its strength is legendary. It's virtually indestructible. Nothing works like Reynolds Wrap.
So this is our handsome devil, huh? Must have been death with the ladies.
You might say that. For instance, when his mistress informed him she was pregnant, he had her eviscerated in front of his eyes, so he could see firsthand. He also was very fond of driving stakes into the breasts of nursing mothers and then impaling their infant upon them.
Okay, I got it. So why do you call this creep a hero?
It is said that history is written by the victors. And Vlad's savagery off the battlefield was nothing compared to him on the battlefield.
So that makes him a hero?
Hmm. You have to understand, he fought for my people's freedom.
I think I prefer George Washington. I find it ironic that a mild-mannered Englishman caused a creep like that to become immortal.
Thanks to Bram Stoker, Vlad truly is one of the undead.
I just can't figure it. How could a man enjoy inflicting pain on innocent women and children?
Unfortunately, what runs through woman's veins can be even colder than that of a man's.
Hey, well, there you are. Come on down.
My great-grandmother's great-grandmother, Elizabeth Bathory.
How sweet.
Don't tell me that you are related to that devil!
Am I missing something here?
Her ancestor is perhaps the most evil woman in history. Countess Bathory, the murderess of over 650 innocent virgins.
And she killed them for their blood.
I don't think I'm going to enjoy this story.
The Countess was born in a Transylvanian castle in 1560. Her family was known all over Europe, and the Countess grew up with wealth and servants all around her. As she grew older, Elizabeth became vain, angry as her youth and beauty began to leave her, and one day she lashed out at a servant. Legend has it that when she rubbed the servant's blood on her hand, a miraculous thing began to happen. Her skin turned pure white, the wrinkles fading away. The Countess thought she had discovered the secret of eternal youth. Elizabeth thought herself above any law, and she began to search for this horrible way to stay young.
She was mad, convinced that only the blood of youthful virgins would work. So hundreds of girls were kidnapped, tortured, and then killed. Also, Elizabeth might bathe in their blood. The peasants were powerless to stop her. And for years, her unspeakable crimes went on, with the blood of the innocent girls pouring like evil water. Finally, the Countess was caught. Elizabeth's noble birth saved her at first, but then the king sentenced her to a fate worse than death. She was walled up alive in her chamber, with no window, no light, just a small hole where food was passed through. She lived for 4 years, until death finally claimed her.
Say what you will, there's something to be said for civilization.
You think that evil like that is confined to the 15th century?
I didn't say that.
Look, Bram Stoker was inspired by the Countess's bloody story, but at the same time he was writing Dracula. Jack the Ripper may still have been walking the streets of London.
It's true, but I still prefer George Washington.
In our own century, need I remind you of some of the hideous crimes that have been committed to satisfy a lust for blood?
No, but I have a funny feeling you will. Ava and I are going out for a breath of fresh air. You just sit here and depress yourself. Come, my dear, walk this way.
What if they were a place where pets came back to life? And if it worked for pets, why not for people?
One of the most successful horror movies ever, Stephen King's Pet Cemetery, now on video cassette from Paramount.
When people first see Airwick Crystal Air Freshener, they say,
ooh.
But Crystal Air works so beautifully in places where you have the toughest odors. After that, it's ah in the kitchen.
Ah.
Ah in the bathroom. Crystal Air works beautifully.
Ah.
Even after lying around for 3 years, today's Duracell batteries still have up to 90% of their life. There's a date that proves it. So you've got nothing to be afraid of. Today's Duracell, with 3 year storage.
Know what I like best about tap dancing?
It's not the way.
And I can practice on linoleum. After Mom picks me up from tap lessons, I keep her company while she makes dinner. Tap dancing makes you very hungry, especially for burgers and Ora-Ida tater tots. Life would be perfect if I could eat tater tots every day and the whole world was covered with linoleum.
Softness that won't wash away. That's important to Dr. Paula Couture, who washes her hands throughout the day. So she uses Eversoft lotion from Jergens. Eversoft is the remarkable lotion that won't wash off the next time she washes up. Yet Eversoft is not greasy. Now your hands can feel as soft as Dr. Paula Couture's. Eversoft lotion from Jergens. You won't wash away the softness.
When Ocean Spray adds sweet, plump strawberries to tangy cranberries, something cool and refreshing happens to salads.
Mmm!
Cranfruit brand sauces add a cool, refreshing
zing
to everything.
If you're up to here with thick, liquid fiber laxatives, ask your doctor or pharmacist about FiberCon. Get all the natural action of fiber to help you be regular in easy-to-swallow tablets. FiberCon. Your choice is clear.
Silly girl. Imagine her leaving me just because she had to cook dinner for a family. Oh, she invited me, of course, but I've never been a big fan of stewed goat. Stalking vampires gives me an appetite, and I swear I smell food somewhere. This must be the place. Well, let's see what's behind door number two.
Look, even in prison, he couldn't give up his bad habits.
I don't believe in these mice and birds.
Doesn't matter what you believe in, it's the evidence. He used to impale mice and birds.
How nice to see you again.
Thank you.
Have you enjoyed your stay at the castle?
Well, enjoy isn't exactly the word I'd use.
I'd like you to meet my colleague, Professor Raymond McNally from Boston College.
How do you do, Professor?
He had the idea of the original book that we have just written.
Nice meeting you, George. Please sit down and join us.
Oh, great. Your colleagues, eh?
Yes, in fact, we've written a new book on the life of the historical Dracula, Prince Vlad the Impaler.
You don't happen to have a copy of it, do you?
As a matter of fact, I do, George. And it's called Dracula, Prince of Many Faces. And it's coming out this Halloween.
You're not going to make a movie of this, are you?
We hope to, George.
Well, in that case, I'm dying to read it.
Great. Great.
I was just hearing some very interesting stories about Vlad, actually. Now, do you think that he was a hero? I mean, this other historian says he was George Washington of Romania.
I don't think we should fight about it. Now, let's enjoy our meal.
Oh, this looks good. Now, what's on the menu here, then?
Well, you may know, of course, that Stoker wrote Dracula, Bram Stoker, right. But he also did some serious research on the foods of Transylvania. And as a matter of fact, we're having this very meal that Jonathan Harker, the real estate agent, had when he was on his way to meet Count Dracula.
Really? What is this, broiled breast of bat?
I think it's paprika chicken.
Ah. What's this, white wine?
Yes, it's a special wine from the local area called Golden Mediash. May I offer you some?
I do not drink wine. Little holdover from love at first bite. I'll have some of that shish kebab, though.
Yeah, the locals call this a robber steak. Oh. And actually, you know, Stoker put some stuff called implizzata, which is eggplant. And that's, of course, the last meal that Jonathan Harker had when he was on his way to meet you-know-who.
Yeah, I know who. Yeah, and I know why now. Why is the vampire myth so strong in this area?
Well, of course, vampire belief is universal, George. You find it all over the world. But it's particularly strong in this part of the world because so many different ethnic groups are joined together here. And each of them have their own special stories, and that creates a very elaborate folklore.
Kind of a cultural goulash, eh?
Yeah, as a matter of fact, that's sort of the way Stoker put it in the novel. He said it seemed as if almost every conceivable superstition had been gathered together in this horseshoe of the Carpathians.
Getting back to Vlad, just what was his problem anyway? I mean, as a little boy, he must have been on the wrong side of Santa's naughty and nice list.
He was a victim of circumstance. He saw his father killed, his brother sodomized, another brother buried alive. You have to see his life to prison. Boss.
Well, he had a rough childhood, George. Of course, that's true. But a lot of people have had rough childhoods, and they don't end up as adults sticking other human beings on stakes like popsicles.
No, not at all. But Professor, you told me that they considered him a hero. He must have had a pretty good PR guy, huh?
I think he was, first of all, the founder of the Romanian state, and he maintained the country's independence against the Turks.
Yeah, but it was at an incredible price. Let me give you just one example, George. I mean, he took the poor, the sick, he invited them to a great banquet, he gave them plenty to eat, and after they were full from drink and from food, he said to them, "Is there anything else I can do for you?" They said, "Yes, if we could be relieved of our daily cares," because they expected some great gift from him. But instead, he had his henchmen come along, and they bolted down all the doors and the windows, and they burned the whole place alive. So all those unfortunate people were burned. And then at the end of it, he said, "Well, I did what they asked me to do. They don't have to worry about their daily cares anymore. I've sent them to heaven."
Kind of an original trick-or-treat, eh?
I think these poor were vagabonds. They were assassins. They were ne'er-do-wells, drug dealers.
Well, wait a minute. Ne'er-do-wells and drug dealers. What about those diplomats, George? This is in our book, too. They came to visit Dracula, and they failed to take off their skull caps in his presence. So he said to them, "Why have you dishonored me in such a way? You should bare your heads in my presence, because I'm a great ruler." And they said, "Lord, it's our custom never to bare our heads to any man." So he said, "All right, I'll have you confirmed in your custom." So he had his henchmen come out with very tiny iron nails. They nailed those skull caps to the heads of those diplomats. And then he said, "Look, you go home, tell your master, fine, you can keep his customs in his own land. But when he comes to visit a great ruler such as myself, he better go along with my customs."
As the leader of a small country, I think he had a sense of dignity, a sense of protocol.
You call that protocol?
Well, glad you guys are in such agreement here, huh? You said earlier that the vampire stories came out of a kind of a folk tradition in Transylvania. Was there any real evidence of vampires? I think that's what all of us really want to know. Yeah. Is there?
Yes, there is, George, as a matter of surprising as it may sound. There's a, well, I think for all diseases and all kinds of superstitions, they've got to go back to some sort of real historical reality, some kind of scientific basis. And in this case, there is a disease called porphyria. Well, porphyria was a disease that was only properly diagnosed in the 20th century. And what happens here is there was a 1985, as a matter of fact, a Canadian fellow, expert, testified that this may have been the disease at the basis of vampirism. And in fact, we do know that among the Eastern European nobility, and especially those living in old Transylvania, there was a lot of intermarriage to keep the property in the family. And that broke down the genetic structure. And so a lot of these people developed these skin lesions and had these problems with the blood, and they couldn't stand the bright light because it hurt their eyes. And you put all that together, and when they lost that blood 500 years ago, physicians told them they should drink human blood to replace it. And three guesses where they got the human blood from: their own peasants. So when the peasant said, hey, there was a vampire up there in the castle, he wasn't kidding. A blood drinker.
Right. Do people suffer from this disease today?
Unfortunately, there are some 50,000 cases in America alone. But it's quite different today, because there have been scientific advances, though there's still a great deal to be done.
Imagine a vampire disease.
Well, it can be treated if handled properly. And as a matter of fact, these people are rather unfortunate in having been saddled with this sort of vampire connection, because most of them live quite normal lives, generally speaking, and they don't seek treatment sometimes because of this stigma, sort of this connection with vampirism. So they've got enough problems of their own without being saddled with this new one.
Well, it's been a pleasure meeting you two gentlemen. The food was great. I have to say that the dinner conversation is a little bit on the revolting side. do you know where the main salon is? I've got to meet Bernard Davies there.
Oh, sure. That's an easy one. What you have to do is you go out this door on the right, and then you head down the corridor.
Wait,
on
sure
the left.
Door on the right. I think it's the door on the left.
No, it's on the right. You go down the left here, and then you'll come to a corridor, and there's another door down there. Go down four steps.
You will stumble down a precipice. This is precisely the wrong way.
Stumble down a precipice?
I think this is precisely down the precipice of the castle.
I don't want to do that.
No. That's the other way around.
No, you have no sense.
Follow his instructions.
You have no sense of direction.
You have
intellectuals. Which way do we go?
We have
this way.
Look, the problem is quite simple.
This 10 times.
I've looked at those places.
We got lost in the mountains of the castle.
Well, I'm the one that found Aigri-Guz all by myself, and I found that place where Dracula was captured.
You never found that original portrait that was supposed to be.
Well, you didn't either, because you were with me. And you couldn't even locate
the place. Yeah, but we were confused by your directions.
My directions? You were the one that was driving. You had been there before in Austria.
You've always misled us in terms of geography, because I have a better sense of it.
When we come back, we will take a midnight stroll through Highgate Cemetery, a setting for one of the only confirmed sightings of a 20th century vampire. We'll also come face to face with some of history's most notorious blood killers as Dracula, live from Transylvania, continues.
They've tried to serve him up in many ways.
Bake it, fry it.
But no remake could ever surpass the terror of the original, The Thing.
We underestimate this guy.
And now we've made The Thing more electrifying than ever, in color.
You're wiser than anything on Earth.
Don't miss the discovery of the century.
You realize what we've found?
A shocking special color presentation, The Thing.
A world television premiere, Thursday night at 8, as Spirits in the Night Week continues on Channel 20.
This is not your typical ghost story.
And he's not your typical ghost.
What is it?
It's the Catterville Ghost.
It reminded me of my great achievements.
Starring Academy Award winner Sir John Gielgud, Ted Wass, Andrea Markovici, and Alyssa Milano. He'll have you screaming with laughter.
Friday night at 8 on WTXX TV, Channel 20.
Thumbs up, America! Christ will live it, way to go! Thumbs up, America!
In
Introducing this 40-1990 Plymouth Sundance with $300 factory cash back, or get $500 cash back on Sundance RS. Plymouth Horizons with air conditioning gets $750 cash back.
America's way to go!
America's way to go is New England's way to go.
You're up.
I'm sleeping.
You were walking.
I was walking in my sleep.
Have your coffee.
Hey, yours is darker than mine.
Mine's decaffeinated Folgers crystals. Yours is the decaffeinated you always drink.
Do you use the same amount?
Yeah, watch. Mine's mountain grown Folgers.
Nice aroma.
A sip?
Yeah. I thought I was the reason you're always so bright-eyed in the morning.
Oh, you are.
Decaffeinated Folgers crystals. So dark and rich, shouldn't you switch?
I'm Gilbert Reynolds, auto technician at Jengris Motor Cars. Fixing automobiles used to be just a hobby of mine. Then I enrolled at the Hartford Technical Institute. Now I'm a professional, working on Mercedes-Benz and BMWs and getting top pay.
There's no room for amateurs in today's skilled job market. At Hartford Tech, you too can turn pro. At Hartford Tech, you can learn from the pros in an authorized service center. If your career is going in the wrong direction, turn it around. Turn pro at Hartford Technical Institute.
Hartford Technical Institute. Call 249-8688.
I don't know about you, but it sure gives me the creeps to think that Vlad the Impaler may have walked this very same hallway. I'd hate to have been invited to one of his dinner parties. RSVP or else, whatever you do, don't ask for a steak. Kind of getting used to this castle, though. I admit it's a bit on the drafty side, and it could use a spot of paint, but it has potential. Take this room, for instance. Now, this could be the family room. Depends on what family. The Manson family, maybe. Bernard!
Hello, George. What a pleasant surprise. You know, I was just examining this rogues gallery, a virtual who's who of blood killers.
I don't know much about art, but I know what not to like. Who are these people?
Well, here we have Gilles de Retz. Now, he was a contemporary of Dracula's father. Gilles was a noble, a soldier, Marshal of France. One day on the battlefield, he discovered that as men lost blood, so they grew weaker. And so he had this mad idea.
Wait a minute, I can see where this is going.
Well, the idea that if he could drink blood, he'd stay young. But he felt he needed the blood of young men. So, by the time he was hung, he had killed 800 boys. Elizabeth Bartry.
I know all about
character.
Her. I've heard about her.
Well, how about John Haig? Now, he's an Englishman. Worth more's the pity. Well, by the time he was apprehended and hung in 1949, he killed at least 9 people. And after shooting them, he'd drain their blood into a glass, drink it down. Then he'd dispose of their body in a little sulfuric acid. You know, he turned himself in the end and confessed to everything. It seemed as if he was glad to make an end of it all.
These men aren't vampires, are they? They're sort of homicidal maniacs. That isn't the same thing, is it?
Oh, no, I couldn't agree with you more. Calling pathological monsters like this vampires only confuses the issue concerning real vampires, the undead ones, I mean. And yet, you know, oddly enough, in the only preface to Dracula he ever wrote, Bram Stoker, in the Icelandic translation of 1898, he recalled the terrible Jack the Ripper murders of 10 years before. And even more intriguingly, in the book, he locates one of Count Dracula's hideouts in the East End of London, only a few hundred yards from 3 of the sites of the Ripper's murders.
Really?
Bloodstained territory like that suited the Count. But what would you say if I told you that in modern London, a vampire had been repeatedly seen stalking through a cemetery, sightings which have been reported as fact to the police?
Really? Well, I would say it would probably George Hamilton doing a sequel to Love at First Bite. You're kidding, of course.
Well, decide for yourself. It was in the winter of 1970 when ordinary people began reporting the most extraordinary things taking place in Highgate Cemetery.
This I gotta see.
Thank you.
When Bram Stoker set some of the London scenes in Dracula in a rambling old graveyard next to Hampstead Heath, people naturally assumed that he meant Highgate Cemetery, once the favoured burial ground for the rich and elite. So much so that by World War I, a flourishing local folklore already associated the place with vampires. Around 1970, when it was overgrown, neglected, there were constant reports in the press of people claiming to have seen a shadowy figure gliding through the cemetery. Some even followed this figure into a particular tomb that seemed to be its home. One evening, a few brave souls went inside. There they found evidence that something very strange was going on. They found blood. Tiny droplets of fresh blood. These stories began to attract attention. Reporters began to descend on the cemetery. But they saw nothing. The sightings kept occurring, however. And finally, a vampire expert visited the cemetery. He carefully placed a crucifix on the bloody tomb. Garlic was scattered, and incense was burned at the entrance. It was thought that whatever walked in the cemetery would walk no more.
Find this vampire expert anyway. Did they place an ad? Wanted. Person conversant with arcane ritual and superstition. Reasonable evening hours. Must provide own sharpened stakes.
No, he volunteered. Sean Manchester was your friendly neighborhood expert. In 1975, he wrote a simple, unvarnished account of what he and his friends found when they followed the trail to a certain family tomb. One coffin too many. And in it, a body. Uh-huh. Oh, perfectly ordinary body, to be sure, but it seemed a little too fresh, not dead enough. Besides, it had no business to be there. There had been no recent admissions. Well, to drive a stake through it would have been a criminal offence, so they ritually purified the tomb and it was blocked up shortly after.
Well, was there any proof that all this happened? I mean, it sounds like all the physical evidence sort of vanished into the air.
Certainly. It didn't stop the uncanny events and disturbances in Highgate Cemetery. No stake, you see.
Aha, mistake, you see.
Exactly. A week later, a missing man was found in the cemetery with a wound in his throat, covered in blood. Poor chap died shortly after. But, you know, Mr. Manchester did rather spoil it when he wrote a book 10 years later, containing a second account, full of the most lurid details. This time, the thing in the coffin had red glaring eyes and a snarl showing long, white pointed fangs clotted with stale blood. And its breath stank. Well, naturally. And the entrance to the tomb wasn't just bricked up. No, it was sealed with cement, mixed with garlic.
The whole
thing reads rather like, Dracula. But who knows?
Cement with garlic, huh? Sort of like the pizza I had last night. Well, I have some investigation to do of my own, like trying to find my way out of here. Bernard, it's been a pleasure seeing you, but I'm just wondering how I get out of here.
George, here, take this. You'll need it. Trust me, it's dark down there.
It's better to light one torch
than to be cursed in the darkness.
That's the way it goes, huh? Do you know the way out?
Oh, yes.
Well, which way is it?
Well, you know where the dungeon is located?
Yes.
But if you continue down the curving stone steps for about 75 feet until you come to the head of a stone wolf.
This is going to take a while. Why don't I see you all in a few minutes? Now, is that the master dungeon or the guest dungeon?
Its strength is legendary. It's virtually indestructible. nothing works like Reynolds Wrap.
Ring around the collar was just the beginning. Introducing Advanced Action Whisk.
Tisk, tisk, tisk. Whisk, whisk, whisk. Tisk, tisk, tisk. Whisk, whisk, whisk. Tisk, tisk, tisk.
New Whisk has a special stain-seeking formula that cleans your whole wash like never before. Ring around the collar was just the beginning.
Tisk, tisk, tisk.
It's the best whisk ever. New Advanced Action.
Whisk, whisk, whisk.
There's a foil so strong, when it comes to cooking, it really cleans up. Nothing works like Reynolds Wrap.
14 years of marriage, you think you know someone. And then one night, it's like a different woman. Oh, I admit it was kind of exciting. A plain old Tuesday night, and suddenly, pie for dessert.
Mrs. Smith's ready-to-serve desserts.
An honest-to-goodness lemon meringue pie. On a Tuesday. I don't know. One day, same old. The next day, va-va-va-boom.
I like to keep them guessing.
They won't be expecting it, but they're gonna love it. Mrs. Smith's Desserts. Surprise someone tonight.
I know what you like. You can't fake it.
Tyson breast patties.
I know the play before you make it.
And microwave sandwiches, bun and all.
We're just family, you and me. Tyson. Feeding you is good. Can be.
For your family, we make our patties from only the finest Tyson chicken breast.
Tyson's feeding you like family. Tyson's feeding you.
Pulsing, throbbing pain. When doctors were asked what they take more often for their everyday pain, Tylenol, extra strength Tylenol, Advil, or Bayer, more doctors take Bayer. For pain, Bayer is the wonder drug that works wonders.
Facing the world with a cold sore can be very embarrassing. So from the first tingle, I use Camphophonique Cold Sore Gel. It goes to work instantly on my cold sore. Camphophonique Cold Sore Gel helps me face the world.
You should take a left at the dungeon. Straight past the hidden staircase, and a sharp right at the torture chamber.
Torture chamber.
I've done all that, and I still can't find the library. Maybe this is the way. That's not the way. What's the sound? Mice?
What are you doing here?
What are you doing here?
Do you know where you are?
If I knew where I was, I wouldn't be here.
All right, come, come. There is a remote chance that Dracula was buried here, in this secret chamber.
In this secret chamber?
Mm-hmm. Empty? You sure that's empty? Of course it's empty. His remains would have long since crumbled into dust. You know, like the center of a spider web, secret passages radiate in all directions. In fact, if we wanted to, we could even go outside the castle through this passage here.
That's a great idea. It's, kind of drafty down here.
These passages might explain how Dracula was able to appear and disappear without warning. None of this nonsense about turning into a bat.
What you're saying is that all these peasant superstitions are just superstitions. They all have explanations.
Many do, many do not. Now, if you come with me, I'll tell you more on our way out. Please, après-vous?
Après-vous. You first.
You didn't tell me there are rats down there.
But you weren't scared, were you?
Me? Absolutely terrified.
Oh. Gypsy camp?
Yes.
Maybe Ava's home.
Now, if you look closely, you still can see the ancient methods of warding off vampires. Foolish, but effective.
Well, I know garlic, but,
poppy seeds.
Poppy seeds?
Mm-hmm. Vampires apparently have a real taste for poppy seeds. So at night, they sprinkle a circle of seeds around the encampment.
I don't get it.
Well, they feel that the vampire will be too busy picking the seeds up to worry about attacking them. And by the time he's through, it will be daylight, and we all know what happens then.
Well, now, this one I know about. That's the old stake in the heart.
Exactly. But that is not enough. The head of the vampire must also be chopped off.
And the body burned in the fire.
Mm-hmm. Exactly.
Do your people still believe in vampires?
Things have changed since Prince Vlad's time.
You didn't answer my question.
Well, yes, we do. There is a part of everybody that believes in the power of darkness. And that darkness lies within us all. At least my people acknowledge it.
Help! Somebody help!
Help! Quick, help!
What happened?
I found him in the woods.
Is he?
Yes. There is not a drop of blood in his body.
Next, he's gonna say...
Look, on his neck, teeth marks.
I've seen it all before.
We must return to the castle and put an end to this nightmare once and for all. We must destroy the creature's coffin, and when daylight comes, kill him.
I too will join you.
Hold on a second. If he is in the coffin, I really don't believe he's gonna appreciate a wake-up call.
That's why I'm bringing this.
Why don't you need a...
We are prepared. Are you?
Look, you know I don't believe in vampires. They don't really exist. But just in case.
Après vous. Kit Fatchat.
Egan.
If you're all right. Let's stay together. I don't want you to get lost.
Well, you go forward, and we'll go that way.
Call me if you find him.
When we return, we'll meet real-life vampires who just might be your next-door neighbors. As Dracula, live from Transylvania, returns.
When you have trouble falling asleep, take the sleeping aid ingredient that's the doctor's choice, the one in Sleepinol. In a survey, 7 out of 10 doctors chose the sleeping aid in Sleepinol. Sleepin' All contains the doctor's choice to fall asleep fast.
McDonald's has a monster of an idea. Happy Halloween certificates. A book of 10 is only a dollar. Your gang can turn them in for free dessert treats like cones and sample-size sundaes at McDonald's. Each book also comes with a mail-in certificate for this free Roger Rabbit when you buy your video cassette of the smash hit Who Framed Roger Rabbit. McDonald's Happy Halloween certificates. A deal so good, it's eerie.
This year, 10 million people will buy a new car.
Turn the key. Feel free.
And today's sophisticated engines deserve an equally sophisticated fuel. Exxon 93 Supreme. The fuel that lets you concentrate on why you bought the car in the first place.
Turn the key.
Exxon 93 Supreme. Precision equipment for precision engines. Just turn the key.
This is not your typical ghost story. And he's not your typical ghost.
What is it?
It's the Catterville Ghost.
It reminded me of my great achievements.
Starring Academy Award winner Sir John Gielgud, Ted Wass, Andrea Markovici, and Alyssa Milano. He'll have you screaming with laughter.
Friday night at 8 on WTXX-TV, Channel 20.
Want a fresh approach to your day? Try new Summer's Eve Feminine Powder. Specially formulated for a clean, fresh, dry feeling that lasts all day. Cool, comfortable, confident. New Summer's Eve Feminine Powder. Feel fresh all day.
How did I get myself into this? Host a live special, they said. Easy work, they said. Wait till I get a hold of my agent. I'll put a stake in his heart.
What am I talking about? Agents don't have hearts.
Who are you?
Noreen Dresser.
The author?
Right.
Forgive me for raising my stake, but you never know who you're going to be running into in this place.
Right, I don't blame you.
What brings you to Transylvania? You actually look like a normal person.
Well, I hope so, George. You know, I wrote a book called American Vampires, and I thought it was important to come over to this side of the world and check things out in the heartland of vampires.
What got you hooked on vampires?
I'm a folklorist, and I've discovered that there's vampires everywhere in our culture.
Are there people who have actually gone so far as to become vampires?
Yes, they even drink blood.
Whoa. Now, hold on. It's one thing to imagine vampires lurking around a place like this, but are you telling me that they might be in the neighborhood shopping centers?
Could be. You know, I found them in my research. They're in the supermarkets, yes, because they can be flight attendants, they can be hospital workers, teachers. You never know.
Noreen, I've got to ask you something. How do these people actually practice vampirism? How do they do that?
It took me a long while to find out because they're very secretive. But after 18 months, I finally made a very strange and disturbing discovery.
There are people who call themselves vampires. I discovered a group of 4 or 5 people on the East Coast of the United States who were engaging in this practice of drinking one another's blood. There was one young woman, Pam. Of course, I never use people's true names. Melody remembers the first time she met Pam, the vampire. It was 1985, and Melody's friend Brad had arranged the meeting. Pam's always looking for someone else. Would you be interested? The modest apartment filled with books and plants was located in an East Coast city and seemed almost secluded because of the quiet created by the well-insulated building. Brad was stretched out on the sofa. Pam kneeled over him as Melody sat on the floor next to them and leaned forward to catch every detail. First, Pam massaged Brad's back, and then once he became relaxed, she began to sensuously lick the fingertips of his left hand. Pam stabbed one of Brad's fingers with a sterilized hypodermic needle of the type normally used for animals. She pierced the skin, squeezed the finger, squeezed some more, then she sucked from it. When she finished one finger, she repeated the steps with the next one, licking each finger when she was finished. To Melody, it all seemed quite mysterious, but she wasn't afraid. I felt pretty good. I'm an adventurous person, so I do kind of crazy off-the-wall things, she explained. After spending about 20 minutes stabbing Brad's fingers and then sucking them, Pam turned to Melody and said,
"Okay, you're next."
Thus began Melody's initiation into the act of vampirism, playing the role of donor for Pam's belief in her need for fresh, warm human blood. I think I have to make clear that this is not some wild, orgiastic sort of goings-on. It was very calmly and sedately carried out.
What was that? That was one of the weirdest things I've ever seen. You can't be serious. People do that for fun? Why?
There are people on the other side of that door who could answer the question for you.
Vampires?
Yes.
Real vampires? You're telling me the real vampires and they're here?
Yes, would you like to meet them?
No. Meeting real vampires wasn't part of my deal.
Well, suit yourself.
One thing to talk about 15th century vampires, but 1989? Forget it. She does this kind of thing for a living. Just go ahead on in. I'll stand guard out here. Yes, sir. I'll wait for you right here. What about you? Okay, you're gonna be sorry.
Hi, Brad. It's good to see you. You know, you've told me that you're a donor. That means you give blood to vampires?
I did.
I see. And can you tell me how that came about?
Well, I met a woman who, in all other respects, seemed to be functioning, married, had a full-time job. I myself had an interest in horror movies, and this woman professed a desire to drink blood. And I decided to experiment on a personal level in order to further acquaint myself with this.
Mm-hmm. And tell me, what does the drinking of blood do for you? Why, in other words, why, I can understand you're being curious about it, but you know, really, why are you doing it beyond the curiosity?
The reason that I did it principally was because I was amazed that a person could drink blood altogether. Uh-huh. On a scientific level. And I did find that it gave me a pleasurable feeling after the act was performed.
A pleasurable feeling?
It was a pleasurable feeling.
I see.
More like wanting to fall asleep after a hard day on the job, so to speak.
I see. Okay, and Monique, it's nice to have you here. Do you consider yourself a vampire?
Yes, I do.
And that means that you actually drink human blood?
Yes.
And how long has this been going on?
For about 6 years.
For 6 years. I see. And about how often does this occur?
Well, it goes in cycles. Sometimes it can be consecutively for 3 or 4 days, mm-hmm. or sometimes once a week, or sometimes every couple of months.
And when you consume blood, are we talking in what kinds of quantities?
Well, I never measured the amount.
Well, I mean, a gallon, quart, teaspoon.
Oh, I'd say about half a glass.
Oh, that much. And it's easy for your donors to give forth that much at one time, or would you say that's cumulative in one setting or one feeding or whatever you want to call it?
One time.
In one time from one person?
Yes.
I see. And can you tell me from what part of the body you take the blood?
From a vein or an artery.
So we're talking about the arm.
Mm-hmm.
I see. Well, thank you both very much.
Look, just have him call me. Yes, it's important. I happen to be one of his bigger clients. H-A-M-I-L-T-O-N. Oh, never mind. My agent. I want to have him check the fine print on my contract. I want out. This is just getting too weird. So did I miss anything? Okay, I peeked. Those two should really hit it off well. I mean, just think, dating's a snap. You don't have to hassle with dinner reservations. All you need to do is grab a quick bite and make sure he uses a Band-Aid. Oh! Oh, thank God it's you, Bernard. I'm so glad it's you. I just came from the dungeon, and you can't believe what I just saw.
George, you look ghastly.
I look ghastly. You should see them. I was with Noreen Dresser, and they were live 1989 vampires. And they were talking about bloodletting and drinking and donors. It's sick. It's sick.
Oh, George, Bram Stoker did it all before, you know. Count Dracula even became a donor himself in the famous blood baptism scene in Chapter 21. Listen, Dracula gets into the Harker's bedroom, and when their friends break down the door, there's Mina kneeling over the sleeping body of her husband, and both her arms are grasped in one of the Count's hands, and the other is pressing her face down into blood trickling from a wound he's opened in his chest. As Stoker so nicely puts it, like pushing a kitten's nose into a saucer of milk.
But, Bernard, they weren't real. They weren't real vampires. These were real. I don't know about you, but I've had enough fun for one night. I think for now I'm just going to let sleeping vampires lie, and I'm calmly going to walk on out of here. Good night, Bernard.
Sending flowers means sending information long distance. However, during busy periods like Mother's Day, connections aren't always made in time. So this year, FTD switched to US Sprint and successfully processed over 2 million orders. Of course, some results simply can't be measured. 100% digital fiber optic data, only from US Sprint.
Leave the world out there, you know you've done your share. Now you're on your way to the place where it's okay. Toll House, it's good to be home.
Chocolatey, warm Toll House cookies made only with Nestle Toll House morsels. Make your house a Toll House.
Toll House, it's good to be home.
And try Nestle Toll House ready-to-bake cookie dough. They home bake in 10 minutes. Find them in your grocer's freezer.
Even after lying around for 3 years, today's Duracell batteries still have up to 90% of their life. Today's Duracell, date-coded for 3-year storage.
Gee, sounds awful, Bob.
It's no day at the beach, Steve. Sore throat, cough.
Try one of these.
Sugar-free Nice showers your throat with medicine for icy, cool relief.
Oh, cool. Feels better. Guess it's back to work for me.
Put your throat on ice with Nice.
It's almost time. Time for Halloween Fright. A Halloween night when no one comes home. Watch, if you can, Halloween 3, Season of the Witch.
Happy Halloween.
Saturday night at 8 on WTXX TV, Channel 20.
High-tech careers start at Hartech. Be a part of advanced technology, the world of computerized numerical control machining. Hartech can help you move up your earnings and career in just 6 months. Hartech is Pratt & Whitney Machine's authorized training center. If you're good with your hands, good with tools, and interested in computers, Hartech can put you in a better job. If your career is going in the wrong direction, turn it around. Turn pro at Hartech. Call Hartford Tech at 249-8688.
Historian is history. Are you all right?
I'm
Radu?
I know, it's time for us to make a hasty retreat.
But...
wait for me at the carriage. You'll be safe there.
Okay.
I don't care if he's in a meeting. Put me through to him. It's George Hamilton from Transylvania. Not Pennsylvania, Transylvania. Bullets? It's George. How's it going? I'll tell you how it's going. So far, I've met people whose favorite aperitif is human blood. I've seen a woman whose idea of skincare involves mass murder, and I nearly broke my neck tripping over a deceased historian. Yes, a historian. You ask me, how is it going? Bullets, tell me, is there anything in the trades? Travelogue. George Hamilton, Transylvania. One key question, Bullets. When's the next flight out of here? Air Transylvania? Right? Peasant class? Leaves in 1 hour. The last flight for 3 weeks? I'm out of here.
Mr. Hamilton forgot his coat.
Do vampires really exist? Depends on who you ask and where. As far as I'm concerned, I'm all through asking questions. 4 a.m, and I'm out of here. It's over. I got a flight to catch. O-V-E-R.
Thank God you're safe. Where can I drop you?
That won't be necessary.
I can't take you home with me. I'm old enough to be your father.
Do you not remember what I said about a woman's blood being colder than a man's?
Yeah, so what?
I'll explain it along the way.
Suit yourself. Step on it, Igor! Ow!
So that's what they meant by love at first sight.
Of one head. And here's the other.
My. Oh, my.
Twins.
To your next party. They're perfect for small occasions.